the virus gets from bats into people in Bangladesh revolves around this practice of collecting sap from date palm trees. And it's a very common practice throughout Bangladesh, and it's very similar to the way that we tap maple syrup here in Wisconsin. And the way that it works is that a sap collector will climb up a date palm tree, shave off part of the bark and stick in a bamboo spout, and then he hangs up a clay pot to collect the sap overnight. But at nighttime, these bats are foraging and looking for sap and nectar to eat. And when they see the sweet, sticky stuff coming out of a date palm tree, they lick the bark or stick their head into the pot. And so if one of these bats is infected with Nipah virus, it then transmits the virus into the date palm sap. And the sap collector will then take this to the market and sell it by the glass. And if you drink some sap that's been contaminated with the virus, you can become infected yourself. I went to Bangladesh to study the roosting habitats of these fruit bats to see if we could understand how that relates to where we've seen human Nipah virus cases. All of the human Nipah virus cases in Bangladesh have occurred in the northwest or central part of the country, in this area that we now call the Nipah Belt. Given that we think that these bats live throughout the country and that this practice of sap collection is happening throughout Bangladesh, why are we seeing this cluster of human Nipah virus cases? We were interested in the broad ecological aspects of Nipah virus. So rather than looking at individual Nipah case patients, we were looking at villages and the environment around villages in areas where we've seen outbreaks and in areas where we haven't. So the focus of my research was to look at the roosting habitats of these fruit bats. So I found that inside the Nipah Belt, the landscape is very different from the rest of the country. For example, in the Nipah Belt, there's less forest cover, and the forest that's there is much patchier. You would likely see clumps of forest broken up by agricultural land or homesteads, whereas in other parts of the country, you may be more likely to find sort of contiguous jungle areas. I also found that the human population density is much higher inside the Nipah Belt. And interestingly, we found that there are more bat roosts in villages inside the Nipah Belt compared to the rest of the country. So in these areas, there's going to be more interaction between bats and people. Likely they're going to be eating out of the same fruit trees, or bats are going to be running into date palm sap containers, for example, which then increases the chances of Nipah transmission from bats to people. One aspect of this study was to hang up infrared cameras to watch the date palm sap containers at night and basically try to understand how the bats are feeding. When we were hanging the cameras, we always had a lot of spectators, and they were really curious to see what we were doing in the village and what all this equipment was. It was really an unexpected education campaign, really, because it's one thing to say to someone, you know, this is what Nipah virus is, and this is how it occurs when the bats are drinking out of your date palm sap containers. But it's another thing to hang a camera with everybody watching and then take it down the next morning and say, this is what happened in your backyard last night, and for them to actually see photographs of these bats drinking out of their sap containers. They were astounded and immediately wanted to know how they could protect their sap containers so that they could keep the bats out. One outcome of this research is that hopefully we'll be able to target high-risk areas where we're likely to see spillover from bats to people and causing more human Nipah virus cases. If we know where these high-risk areas are, we can target our surveillance and our education campaigns. The Nelson Institute was a great place to do my research. The Environment and Resources Program was presented as this really flexible program where you could just sort of build your own major. And that's exactly what I did. I mean, I probably took classes at 7 different departments on campus easily. Applying for fellowships and postdocs for after graduate school, I talk about how I did this interdisciplinary research and how I'm both an epidemiologist and an ecologist. And I think that that makes me unique in the field of public health and environmental public health. And I don't think that I could have received that training at least as easily at any other university.